Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Sons of Darkness by Gail Z. Martin, narrated by Jeffrey Kafer. Chapter 1. The abandoned warehouse squatted next to a rusting railway spur, the faded paint of its sign almost unreadable against the old brick walls. Too sturdy to knock down, too expensive to gentrify, the decaying building smelled of mold and dust, rats, and blood. Travis Dominick moved silently through the shadows, intent on his prey. Moonlight and the distant glow of streetlights filtered through the dirty windows and skylights, giving barely enough illumination for him to make his way. He knew his quarry had gone to ground here. The ghosts told him so, and the vision that woke him in a cold sweat showed him where to look. With raven dark hair and black clothing, Travis melted into the shadows. There. He saw the creature's matted brown coat as it eased around one of the pillars supporting the roof. In its beast form, the monster was the size of a large wolf or even a mastiff. But that's where the likeness to any normal canine ended. The Nogzer was a vampire shifter, a plague carrier, and it had murdered and eaten an entire family. Travis had come to put an end to its killing spree. He pulled a silver knife from the bandolier across his chest and hurled it. It flew silently and sunk hilt deep into the creature's hindquarters. The beast gave a howl, not from the injury, which Travis knew wouldn't be lethal, but from the shift the silver forced. Sinew and slick muscle glistened as the dirty pelt stripped away into bloody ribbons, and the body reshaped itself when bones broke and knit with a disturbing snap and crunch. The monster hunched, no longer on all fours, but not yet standing upright. A burst of gunfire cut into the creature and pockmarked the pillar behind it, fast shots from an automatic weapon. The beast bellowed, bloodied but not seriously hurt. Then the bullets weren't silver. Fuck. There's a newbie out there who thinks he's Van Helsing. Travis peered out from where he'd retreated with his back to one of the pillars. The creature shook off the last gory remnants of its fur. In the half-light, Travis made out the thing that had once been human, before it brought plague to its family and stripped their bones clean with the knife-sharp teeth of its changed form. More shots tore into the monster's head and body, but the creature did not collapse, needing more than steel to slay it. Then, with a burst of speed, it leaped into the shadows, intent on bringing down its assailant. "Shit," Travis muttered, taking off at a run. "I could have done this the easy way, but no, some Buffy wannabe has to fuck it all up." Travis held a coiled silver whip in his left hand and a Glock with silver bullets in his right. Silver and steel knives of varying sizes filled the bandolier and hung from sheaths strapped to his belt. He had come prepared to destroy the monster. Now he had to save the idiot who had gone looking for trouble and found it. The creature moved fast, leaping for its attacker with its teeth bared and its sharp claws out. A man cursed and the beast yowled in pain. Travis closed in on the scene to find a powerfully built blonde man going after the monster with a K-bar in each hand. Every time Travis moved to line up a shot with a Glock, the combatants pivoted, putting the man squarely in his sights. As annoyed as he was at the interloper, Travis couldn't justify shooting him. The beast stood half a head taller than its opponent, but whoever the dipshit was who had blundered into Travis's hunt, the guy knew how to fight. Travis might have answered to a different authority for his training, but he learned from some of the best, and he recognized the close quarters moves as elite military, maybe special ops. So perhaps the fight was not as uneven as he had first suspected. Travis circled, looking for an opening, figuring he and the mystery man could double-team the creature. "Stay back, I've got this," the blonde man growled, slashing with a knife in his right hand and thrusting with a blade in his left. Unless those knives were edged with blessed silver, Travis knew the other man could harry the creature all day without ever bringing it down. "Get out of the way and I'll finish it," Travis called back. He lashed out with a silver whip, flaying open a deep gash in the monster's back. The beast jerked and turned, recognizing a second threat, but shifted its stance before Travis could get off a shot with a Glock, putting the man between them. "I've told you, I've got—" The reply broke off as the creature put on oppressive speed, swiping its powerful clawed hand across the man's shoulder and tossing him effortlessly through the air. The stranger hit one of the support pillars hard, but he staggered to his feet, ready for another round. "Of all the stupid, asinine fucking idiots," Travis muttered as he tried to flank the creature, but although the beast remained intent on its injured quarry, it was clever enough not to expose its back to Travis. The stranger didn't wait for the beast to attack again. He came at it with kicks and punches and a flurry of expertly trained movement that would have had a human opponent down in seconds. The two long knives sank deep into the monster's body, and the thing howled in fury and pain. It lunged, and claws tore into the fighter's shoulder as the beast opened its maw and bared its fangs, lowering its head toward the struggling man's throat. Intent on fresh blood, the creature made a mistake. Travis dodged into position. He didn't dare shoot into the back of the beast for fear the bullets would go through and hit the man, but three side shots would do nicely, head, chest, and hip. The monster roared and tossed the man aside. This time he did not get up. Travis faced the beast, putting a silver bullet between the creature's eyes and through its heart. It fell to its knees, covered in its own blood and that of its would-be attacker, and leveled a baleful glare. Angry red blisters crisscrossed the monster's pale skin as the blessed silver worked its poison, fighting against the unholy energies that animated the beast. Travis reached for a flask on his belt and sloshed a measure of salted holy water into the creature's ravaged face. Travis raised a hand in blessing. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, let there be extinguished in you all power of the devil. He made the sign of the cross. Through this holy unction, may the Lord pardon thee whatever sins or faults thou hast committed. The Nogzer that had once been a man named Rick Corse collapsed in a bloody heap on the floor. Travis doused the body with lighter fluid and tossed a match, watching the corpse go up in flames, assuring that it would not rise again. He ran to where the stranger lay, fearing what he might find. The man was pale, but still breathing, bleeding from deep gashes where the beast had torn into him. Travis ripped strips of cloth from the man's tattered shirt and field-dressed the wounds, making it unlikely he would bleed out until Travis could get help. Sirens wailed in the distance. Travis hefted the unconscious man over his shoulder in a fireman's carry and dumped him into the backseat of his black Crown Vic, pulling away before the first of the fire trucks reached the scene. He toggled hands-free dialing and the call rang through. I have Matthew standing by. I'm bringing in a casualty. You're bringing someone here? John sounded incredulous. Are you sure? He's not dying, but he's banged up pretty bad, Travis said, trying not to be snappish, despite the adrenaline crash. And before we let go of him, I want to know what the hell he thought he was doing playing Monster Hunter. St. Dismas Outreach took up a hard-worn former hotel off Wiley Avenue in the Hill District of Pittsburgh, a down-on-its-luck neighborhood not far from Center City. Aptly named for the believing thief on the cross, St. Dismas was, as far as most people were aware, a halfway house, soup kitchen, food bank, and shelter, a last-chance outpost for the tired souls who found refuge there. Fewer knew that forays like tonight's battle were equally a part of its vital, if secretive, mission. Travis pulled the car up to the back door. Matthew and John came out to meet him, gentling the wounded stranger onto a stretcher and hustling him into the building before Travis had released his seatbelt. He got out and glanced in both directions. Before they had opened St. Dismas, being in an alley in this part of town in the middle of the night would have been asking for trouble. Travis had been no more willing to put up with human monsters than the kinds of creatures he hunted. It didn't take long for word to spread that hassling the folks at St. Dismas wasn't worth the grief. John met him in the hallway. What happened? John was Travis's second in command, and one of the few entrusted to the knowledge of Travis's past and his nighttime hunts. They were a study in distinctions. At 33 and 6'2", Travis was solid, lean muscle, with chin-length black hair and green eyes that were in sharp contrast to the pale coloring of his Irish heritage. John was 5'10 and 40-something, built like a fireplug, with close-cropped dark hair, wary eyes, and skin the color of espresso. John had been an army chaplain before St. Dismas, and Matthew, who had disappeared with their visitor, had been a medic. Their skills still came in handy on nights like this, far too often for Travis's liking. Travis recounted the mucked-up hunt as they walked to a small apartment on the third floor. So you have any idea who this guy is? John asked, pausing at the door. Trouble, that's what he is, Travis replied wearily. And dangerous. He knew how to fight, just not how to fight a Nogzer. Navy SEAL, maybe, or one of the other special ops. I saw the guns and the knives. Impressive. Travis gave a snort in reply. And it did him so much good. I need to make sure he learns from his mistake and leaves things alone that he doesn't understand. He's gonna know about you when he wakes up, and he'll connect you to St. Dismas. And I know about him too, Travis replied. I'll bet my day job is more understanding than his. John chuckled at the understatement. Yeah, true. All right, I've got the front covered. Go be Batman. Hardly. How's the night going? Travis asked, shifting into work mode. Typical. We've got more people than usual for overnight, but that's probably on account of the rain. The soup kitchen was scraping the bottom of the kettles, but we took care of everyone, John reported. Broke up a fight between a couple of guys who were too high to be able to tell us what they were actually arguing about, he added, shaking his head. You know, the usual. He paused. On the other hand, the group therapy session with the halfway house residents went really well, so there's that. St. Dismas served a tough part of town. While the Steel City had remade itself with software and technology industries after much of its manufacturing went elsewhere, not everyone could make the leap. Travis often wondered how many of the men who sought refuge here would have been just fine in the days when a mill worker could earn enough for a nice house, a decent car, and retirement in Florida. Nothing in their reach paid like that now, or ever would again. Good, Travis said, clapping John on the shoulder. Then I'll go see to our new guest. I wouldn't mind having one of those flashy thingies like that in the movie to make him forget. You sure your connections don't have something? They always have the good stuff, John joked. Travis sighed. I doubt it. If people forgot what they did, why would they need to go to confession? It would have put priests out of jobs, and they can't have that. John left, chuckling, while Travis headed back toward the clinic where his unexpected guest would be recovering. It had taken 3 years for him to be able to joke about the priesthood after making his decision to leave it behind and the secret Vatican order of demon hunters that had nearly cost him his life, his faith, and his sanity. The Sinistrum reported to Cardinal Vasilik, one step away from the Pope himself, and its very name implied its role, the left hand of the Holy Father, fighting things too terrible to acknowledge. Those among the cardinals who did not approve had another name for the elite warrior priests, Filios Tenebrarum, the Sons of Darkness. Right now, what mattered to Travis was finding out where the hell this stranger had come from, and how it was that the man even knew about threats like the Noxzerer. Travis hoped to be able to dissuade their guest from going looking for more trouble, but he doubted that would be easy. He reached the clinic just as Matthew closed the door behind him. How is he? Travis asked, worried about the stranger despite being annoyed that the man had put himself in harm's way. Banged up, but not too badly, Matthew replied. He's gonna be sore, and I had to close up the worst of the gashes with stitches, but considering the alternatives, he's a pretty lucky guy. Travis gave a snort. What's the saying, that God looks after fools and drunkards? He heard a voice shout from behind the door. Matthew gave him a look. Well, that particular fool is demanding to know what's going on. He wants to talk to the boss man, and that's you. Travis grimaced and rolled his eyes. This should be fun, he muttered and shouldered past Matthew to enter the room. Who are you and where the hell am I? Travis got his first good look at their house guest in the harsh light of the clinic. It had been too dark in the warehouse to see much, and the Noxzerer had kept his attention occupied elsewhere. The man sitting on the edge of the clinic bed looked to be in his early 30s, with short blonde hair and a muscular build that suggested boot camp rather than gym rat. The haircut said civilian, but the way the man sat, poised to spring at the first sign of threat, said military. My name is Travis Dominick, and you're at the St. Dismas Center. The stranger gave Travis a glare. The homeless shelter? Travis shrugged. That and more. He took in the set of the man's chin, and the fire in his blue eyes, anger covering fear. Who are you? The newcomer remained silent long enough that Travis began to doubt he would answer. Brent Lawson, he said finally. And don't get me wrong, I appreciate what you did, saving my ass, but why the fuck were you there? A side effect of giving up the clerical collar was that people stopped watching their language around him, Travis thought. The upside was that they now treated him like a human being in all its messy glory. Why were you? He countered. They glared at each other, and Travis was reminded of staring matches back in middle school. Finally, Brent huffed out of breath and looked away. I tracked that thing to its lair, but I had bad intel and the weapons I had didn't work. I noticed, Travis replied. A Noxzerer is a vampire shifter. You needed silver to kill it, and nothing short of a headshot, decapitation, and then burning would do it. Brent gave him an appraising look. And you know this how? Training, Travis replied with a maddening smile. But you still haven't told me how you ended up tracking a monster to a warehouse. It's what I do, Brent said after a moment. At least it's part of what I do. He glanced around. Looks like you're in the part-time monster hunting business, too. Having been a full-time hunter with the Sinistram, Travis was quite content to be part-time, although he couldn't tell Brent that. You would have died back there. I said thank you. Brent's eyes narrowed. Travis leaned back against the wall. You really need to leave this kind of thing to people who've been trained for it. Like you, Father Dominick? Brent couldn't have known about Travis's past, but the barb still made him wince. I'm not a priest. Not anymore, he said quietly. Brent frowned, then managed to look contrite. Sorry, I thought priests only went monster hunting in the movies. And I thought soldiers didn't go freelance. This time Brent flinched. Yeah, well, I'm out now. I have my own detective firm. And someone hired you to look into the family's deaths? Travis guessed. Brent nodded. Yeah, a brother from out of town. When I put the pieces together, I knew it wasn't something the cops would ever believe, so I decided to handle it on my own. Travis tried to unpack that statement because there was as much not said as what Brent admitted. The cops wouldn't believe a monster killed those people, but you did. Apparently, so did you. Travis was in no mood to explain his past, and from the look of it, neither was Brent. So the Noxzare is dead and the family is avenged, Travis said, trying to defuse the stubborn glint in Brent's gaze. Now you can go back to busting workers' comp fraud and finding cheating spouses, or tracking mobsters. Fuck you, Brent said, sliding down off the table and reaching for his shirt. His face and shoulder were already starting to bruise from where the creature had thrown him around, and despite the stitches, the wounds looked sore and puffy. There were older scars, too. Two that looked like bullet wounds, but others that might have been from knives, teeth, or claws. Travis had similar scars, knew what made marks like that. It lent credence to Brent's claims that he wasn't new at this. It's the middle of the night, Travis replied, ignoring the outburst. You're welcome to stay. Matthew would probably like to check in your stitches in the morning. Those claws can carry taint. Not my first rodeo, Brent grimaced as he moved to pull on his shirt. Thanks for the assist and the medic, but I need to get home. You almost died out there, Travis said, blocking his way. And I'm glad you were there, Brent said evenly. But I've been at this for a while now, and it's like any battle. You win some, you lose some. Every fight might be the last. Goes with the territory. Travis reached into a pocket of his tactical vest and pulled out a card. Look, the next time you hear of something like this, how about giving me a call? If I can't talk you out of going after it, maybe we can team up. Safety in numbers? Brent scowled, staring at the card as if debating whether to accept it, then finally snatched it from Travis's fingers and shoved it into his jeans. Yeah, maybe, depends. He moved around Travis. I'd give you my card, but why bother? You'd think you've got it all figured out. With that, Brent walked out and headed down the hallway to the rear exit and into the night. Matthew returned to the clinic before Travis could leave. Did you talk him out of a repeat performance? Travis shook his head. Nope. And I believe him when he said he's done it before. Hell, maybe Special Ops goes after creatures like this for all we know. Not like they tell civilians. Then it's out of our hands, Matthew said. Maybe with luck he'll decide it's a bad business and you'll never run into him again. Travis stared down the empty corridor at the back door. I doubt that. I wonder what his story is. No one starts hunting monsters for fun, he said quietly. They lose someone. It's always personal. Chapter 2. Brent Lawson thrashed, fighting with all his strength against the creature that held him down. He tore free from the bonds that restrained him, overwhelmed by the smell of sulfur and the smoke that burned his eyes. Tasting blood, Brent's heart thudded and his breath came short and fast, sweat plastering his clothes to his body. Another surge and he fell, landing on his hands and knees. Brent opened his eyes, sure he would see the ruins outside of Mosul, where his career and his sanity went up in smoke. Instead, he found himself staring into the carpet on his bedroom floor and trailing the shreds of yet another ruined bedsheet he had torn to pieces. Shit, he mumbled, falling back on his ass. He brought his knees up and covered his face with his hands until his breathing slowed and his heart stopped racing. I'm home. I'm safe. It's over. He chanted silently, repeating the words until the shaking stopped. Only then did he feel the pain. Adrenaline blocked out the ache of bruised muscles and the burn where stitches closed fresh gashes. The blood seeping down his chest told Brent that he had probably popped a few sutures in his wild struggle against the shadows that haunted his dreams. Fuck it all. He staggered to his feet, knowing that he wouldn't be getting any more sleep before dawn. The light in the kitchen guided him. The only thing worse than night terrors was waking in total darkness. Brent turned on the faucet in the sink and ducked his head beneath the cold water, sluicing it over his face and short hair. He came up, dripping like a wet dog, and blotted dry with a hand towel, then grabbed glass and a bottle of Jack Daniels and sat at the kitchen table. Outside, an autumn wind rattled the shutters. The old house on Pittsburgh's south side held both his office and his apartment. A cold draft made him shiver, and his heart spiked again, remembering the slither of icy fingers against his skin in the darkness, on a night not nearly long enough ago. Enough. Brent sucked in a deep breath and let it out slowly, willing himself to be still, hating the way his hand trembled as he poured a couple of fingers of whiskey into the glass. This wasn't the first time he'd had a one-sided conversation with Jack, and it wouldn't be the last, not until he found the fight he couldn't win. Brent ran a hand through his wet hair, then rubbed his neck. When he finally sipped his drink, the glass was steady. The whiskey burned, and Brent knew it would take the edge off both the dreams and the aching muscles from the fight in the warehouse. Shit. Everything had gone wrong so fast. The dream was still vivid. It always was, even after 5 years. He could see the ruins of the village 50 clicks from Mosul, with artillery fire lighting up the night. The sulfur mines were burning again, stinking up the air and settling yellow dust over everything. He and his team were part of a unit fighting the insurgents, but there'd been explosions, and they'd gotten cut off from the others. Under fire in hostile territory, they had ducked into the shell of a stone building, hoping to ride it out until the enemy fighters moved on. Jameson had seen it first, the black shadow that moved all wrong in the moonlight. Hendricks took a shot at it, but the bullet went right through it like it was made of mist. The thing took on the form of a woman, tall and statuesque, with red eyes and sharp white teeth. She didn't notice them at first. The dark and terrible creature swept into the battle, trailing the fog behind her. Men screamed and the rat-tat-tat of automatic weapons split the air, and then only silence.
"What do we do, Captain?"
Jameson had asked. Hendricks and the others had looked to Brent, expecting him to know how to hold off a monster. They didn't cover ancient Sumerian demons in basic training, so it was a damn good thing Brent had played video games.
"Fall back,"
Brent ordered. They couldn't go far. The creature, whatever she was, prowled the ruins ahead of them, and the firefight was still going strong behind them and on both sides. But they needed a defensible position, and what they had at the moment were 3 walls and no roof. He spotted a small house that managed to remain relatively unscathed. It had only 1 room, all the better for defense, and its occupants had fled along with most of the other civilians. The glass was gone from all the windows and its door was torn off the hinges, but it had a roof and the walls were solid.
"I want salt, anything you've got that's iron, whatever will burn, lighter fluid, alcohol, I don't care,"
Brent ordered.
"If you have religious medallions, make sure you're wearing them and have them out. Say a prayer if you're the praying kind. It can't hurt." "What is that thing, sir?"
Benny, the youngest of the team, asked, and while he looked terrified enough to shit himself, he stayed at his post.
"Death,"
Brent replied, although he did not know how right he was until much later.
"How do you fight a demon?"
He racked his brain for what he could remember from games and movies. At his command, Jameson laid down thin lines of salt from what they'd had in their rations and could scavenge from the house where they'd taken shelter. Brent ordered Hendricks to grab any empty bottles he could find, as well as the cooking oil from the house and their lighter fluid, and began making Molotov cocktails.
"Pray over the oil," Brent instructed. "Anybody here got a rosary?"
Benny held one up.
"Right here, Cap."
"Has it been blessed?"
"My grandma brought it back for me from the Vatican," he said. "They told her it was."
"Dunk it into that bucket of water and swirl it around, then say a prayer over it," Brent said. Outside, the screams and gunfire waned.
"What do you think's up with all the funny marks?"
Jameson asked as he finished putting down salt. Brent looked up and followed the soldier's gesture toward the scratches that covered the small building's walls. Brent had heard the game designers and scriptwriters drew on legend and lore, although he'd always doubted the authenticity of their creations. But now, as he recognized the symbols, he had never felt more vindicated for all his hours leveling up.
"That's why the house is still standing," he said reverently.
Some of the scratches looked like intersecting Vs, what one game called witch marks.
On each wall, a pentacle and a circle was surrounded by four crude drawings. The heads of a horned bull, a lion, a crow, and what looked like an Egyptian pharaoh marked the quarters of the circle, and numbers were scratched into each segment of the pentacle. He glanced around, looking for more charms, and saw crossed twigs wound with yarn dangling in front of each window.
"Sir?" Jameson asked. "The symbols, the charms, they're all ways to protect against demons," he said,
still gobsmacked that he seemed to have stepped out of the real world and into one of his games.
"Demons?" Hendrik echoed. "That's what that thing is?"
"Got a better idea,"
Jameson challenged his buddy.
"If the marks work, then where are the people who lived here?"
Benny asked. Brent shook his head.
"No idea. Maybe they went to get food and couldn't get back when the fighting started. Or maybe they were forced out. The marks keep out demons, not people."
"Do you hear that?"
Jameson asked suddenly. Brent and the others paused, but the night had gone quiet. Brent's eyes widened as he realized that the silence was profound.
"They're not fighting anymore," Hendrik said in a hushed voice. "Maybe they moved on?"
Benny replied, and the hope in his voice broke Brent's heart.
"I don't think so," he said. "We stay here until daybreak. The demon's power will be weaker once the light comes up."
"How do you know all this demon shit, Cap?" Jameson asked. "You got a priest in the family?"
He could tell them the truth, that what he knew came from playing games and watching TV, and see their fragile faith shatter, or lie and give them something to believe in.
"Yeah," he replied, "something like that."
They hunkered down, waiting out the night. Then the shouts of insurgents rose over the distant thunder of bombs, and Brent waved his men to stay down and have their weapons ready. He glimpsed a group of a dozen fighters who came charging into what was left of the village like they were late for a party. He couldn't make out their faces, but he bet they were young and angry, anxious to prove themselves. The night grew suddenly cold, and the hair on Brent's arms rose. He gestured for a small band of survivors to stay where they were and remain silent. The wind swept across the wrecked houses and burned out vehicles, whistling through the crevices. A feeling of dread rose in Brent's chest. The insurgents outside, who had at first been jubilant, grew quiet, and then began to shout in terror.
"Mavet! Mavet!"
Boots thudded against the hard ground, followed by gunfire and screams. The last of the men begged and sobbed, then the voices abruptly went silent. Jameson's eyes were wide, white orbs against his dark skin. Benny clutched the rosary, lips moving silently in prayer. Hendrix gripped a gun, his jaw set in anger. Brent held his breath, hoping the angel of death would pass over them. The smell of blood, piss, and gunpowder filled the air. Then red eyes appeared at the window and Brent sprang back with a gasp. Mavet. That was what the insurgents had called the demon, vanished, only to reappear framed in the doorway. Her dark form looked solid, blacker than the night around her. Brent and the others froze, wondering if she would sweep into the house and kill them all, but she did not pass the salt line at the door.
"Throw the bottles," Brent ordered.
Jameson scrambled for the lighter and sent two of the incendiaries through the doorway. The rag stoppers burned bright as the improvised bombs flew through the entrance and burst apart in a plume of flames just outside the house. They could see Mavet clearly silhouetted against the firelight, saw blood dripping from her fangs. The demon was a primal force that lured its victims with a lethal attraction, like the urge to step too close to the edge of a cliff to see the view. Benny moved, but Hendrix clamped a hand on his shoulder and shoved him down.
"Nobody's going anywhere until daybreak," Brent ordered.
Throughout the night, Mavet pounded on the roof and on the walls or threw herself at the open windows and doors, but the wardings held. Benny prayed, switching from the Hail Mary to the Our Father and back again. Jameson hummed hymns that Brent recognized from his childhood in South Carolina. Hendrix hurled bottles of holy water and Molotov cocktails as his curses grew more obscene and creative. A strange inner coldness filtered through Brent, bringing calm and detachment. He had evaded another demon years ago, and it cost him his parents and twin brother. If this was the reckoning for that painful grace, Brent was ready to accept his fate, but he had no desire to hasten it. When the long night finally ended and the sun rose, the sounds of battle ceased. Mavet had vanished with the darkness, leaving behind the savaged bodies of the insurgents. They heard a chopper, and Brent could have wept for joy.
"Don't say anything about Mavet," he cautioned the others. "They won't believe us. Just say we were pinned down and rode out the firefight. That's an order."
Brent's shrill ringtone brought him back to the present, leaving Mosul and the demon in the past.
"Lawson,"
he answered, only belatedly checking the number.
Hey, Brent, it's Mark. I catch you at a bad time?
A glance at the clock told Brent it was just after 2 a.m. Brent scrubbed a hand down over his face to drive away the last of the dreams and memories.
No, I'm awake. What you need?
His southern accent got thicker when he was tired, and the whiskey deepened it.
Just got in. Been out all night after a bunch of ghouls that got loose.
Mark Wojcik's offhanded tone didn't fool Brent. He'd been on those kinds of hunts himself and knew that it took hours for the adrenaline to stop pumping and for the reality of still being alive to sink in.
Sounds like fun, Brent replied.
Ghouls were fast and vicious, but relatively stupid, compared to other creatures, like the Nogzer he and Travis had faced down in the warehouse.
Hey, I called Simon for some research and he said you'd been asked about vampires. You need any help? I can be down there in a couple of hours. I know it's late, but I figured I'd better call. Don't do anything stupid. If it's vampires, let me help. You don't tackle those bastards on your own.
Both Mark and Brent relied on a loose network of experts in the occult, and Myrtle Beach-based folklorists and psychic medium Simon Kincaid was both a resource and a friend. Brent took another sip of whiskey and reminded himself that he was lucky to have friends who gave a damn. Mark usually handled the northwestern corner of the state, near Lake Erie, but on occasion, hunts brought him as far south as Pittsburgh.
I appreciate it, Brent said, and he meant it. But we took the son of a bitch down last night.
We? His pride made him hesitate for a moment, then he decided that Mark probably needed to know about the demon-hunting ex-priest.
I went into a warehouse after the bastard, and it turned out to be different from what Simon and I thought it would be. You ever heard of a Nogzerer? Can't say I have. It's a shifter vamp. I didn't have the right ammo. Fucker would have got me, but this guy came out of nowhere and blew him away. Next thing I knew, I woke up in the clinic of a homeless shelter downtown. Turns out the guy's an ex-priest, and he actually seemed offended that I was monster hunting in his territory.
Brent managed a harsh laugh.
Ex-priest? Mark echoed. Did he have ninja moves?
Brent frowned, not sure whether Mark was poking fun.
Actually, kinda.
Shit, Mark muttered.
That means he probably is, or was, Sinistram. They're trouble.
Brent pinched the bridge of his nose. He'd grown up nominally Methodist, and so the intricacies of Roman Catholicism eluded him.
What's Sinistram? Aren't they the guys you work for?
No, I report to the Oculatum. Our priests are advisors and do exorcisms and that kind of thing, but they pay guys like me to do the fighting. The Sinistram? They're badass. If the Oculatum is the church's version of the FBI, then the Sinistram is Vatican Black Ops. No one's even supposed to know they exist.
Brent knocked back the rest of his whiskey and poured himself another.
So I'm guessing they wouldn't take kindly to rogue agents like me.
His demon hunting was unofficial and very personal.
Yeah, no, not so much. You're saying he broke cover to take you back with him? You expected him to leave me there?
Mark's silence suggested that very thing.
I've only heard whispers about the Sinistram, but they're the kind of guys who shrivel the nuts off the biggest badasses in the room. So watch your step and don't spread the story around. Who am I going to tell besides you and Simon?
Brent replied. It's not like I post this stuff on the internet.
Speaking of Simon, Mark replied, veering the conversation to a new topic. He wants you to call him at a decent hour. Said he has a message for you.
A chill went down Brent's spine. Simon Kincaid was a gifted medium and clairvoyant, as well as being a walking encyclopedia of folklore and mythology. If Simon had a message, then it was almost certainly from the other side of the veil. Brent could tell from Mark's voice that the other man had started to wind down from the hunt.
Get some rest, Brent advised. I'll do my best to steer clear of ninja priests, but if you know of a good place to stock up on silver-coated hollow points, text me. I apparently need to up my game.
Mark promised to send him a reliable source for the ammo and ended the call. Brent stared out the kitchen window as he finished his second drink. He was too wired to sleep, even after the whiskey, and it would be hours yet before he could call Simon. Brent's office, Lawson Investigations, didn't open until 9, not that a private investigator got a lot of walk-in business. With a grunt, he got up and walked to the counter and started a pot of coffee brewing. Then he grabbed his laptop from the ottoman in the living room and brought it to the kitchen table. Brent spent a couple of hours chasing down details for the 2 open investigations he had under contract. Those jobs paid the bills, but they weren't what drove him. He poured another cup and shifted his focus. Brent needed another hunt to occupy his time and keep his mind off old nightmares. By now, he knew what to look for in unsolved murders and cold cases, details that didn't add up, oddities more likely to be supernatural than psychopathic. Missing person cases were usually a good place to start.
Brent settled in, bringing the coffee pot over to minimize distractions, and started combing through reports for anything that seemed odd. Most folks didn't like to think about how many adults went missing every day. Big cities, small towns, and places in between, people vanished, and a disturbing number were never seen again. Sure, some of those were runaways or people intentionally looking to leave their old life behind, although that was much more difficult now than it used to be, unless you were a CIA operative or in witness protection. Many of those missing individuals would eventually be found, victims of violent crime and trafficking, or wandering the streets, homeless and drugged. Some were never found. When Brent left the army and went to work for the FBI, he chased his share of serial killers. He knew that some of the psychopaths remained on the loose, evading capture. But the small number of true serial killers weren't prolific enough to account for the rest of the missing people. Brent chalked those disappearances up to a different kind of monster. He'd spent 3 years with the FBI, but even then he couldn't escape run-ins with the demonic. He'd quit rather than risk the lives of his team and ended up here in Pittsburgh, taking a job as a beat cop, working the night shift until he could get his investigator's license and go out on his own. The PI work paid the bills. Hunting monsters was purely for revenge. A text message pinged. A glance told him it was his girlfriend, Angela, bored with a night shift at the medical center. "Slow night. You up?"
"Couldn't sleep. What, no drunks in the ER?" Brent texted back.
Angela worked rotating shifts as a trauma nurse at the University of Pittsburgh Medical Center and usually came off nights with stories of shootings, DUI accidents, and gang fights. She rarely had enough downtime to eat, let alone be bored. It's Wednesday, they're waiting for the weekend. Brent had met Angela when a fight gone wrong with a ghoul had landed him in an ambulance. He'd been able to blame the gashes on a car accident, but the upside was meeting Angela. That she'd stuck around after he finally told her his whole story still amazed him. But Brent wasn't about to question good fortune because it happens so rarely.
"Just as well you're working, I would have woken you up. Dreams."
He didn't need to say more. Angela had woken to his cries and thrashing more than once, and each time Brent was certain she'd walk out, disgusted by how broken he was. So far, she proved him wrong.
"Wish I'd have been there. I get off at 7. See you later."
"Be careful in the parking lot."
"Always," she replied, adding a couple of hearts and a sultry, winking smiley for good measure.
By the time the sun rose, Brent had found half a dozen disappearances that didn't fit any of the usual patterns. That was suspicious, but when he plotted the last known locations on a map and found them all along Interstate 80, and all within the past 4 months, he knew he was onto something. In each case, witnesses had spotted a large black truck, no plates, and no description of a driver. He sat back, staring at his screen with satisfaction. Challenge accepted. His ringtone startled him, and Brent glanced at the ID.
"Simon, you're up early." "I've got inventory to put away at the store before we open," Simon replied.
He ran Grand Strand ghost tours in Myrtle Beach, South Carolina, and his shop also stocked a wide variety of crystals, charms, and amulets, as well as other protective supplies.
"I was going to give you a call in a bit. Mark said you had a message for me."
Brent steeled himself, afraid of what Simon would say next.
"Yeah, from Danny."
Brent closed his eyes and took a deep breath. One hand gripped the edge of the table, white-knuckled and his gut clenched.
"Tell me." "You know he doesn't mean to hurt you," Simon said gently.
"I know, it's just, yeah," Simon agreed.
"I understand."
He paused and Brent guessed that carrying messages from beyond took a toll on the medium as well.
"He worries about you,"
Simon went on in a quiet voice.
"He doesn't blame you.
Old news.
He said, sherry and coal mine and not the first time. Does that make sense to you?"
Brent shook his head, even though he knew Simon couldn't see him. That meant Simon also couldn't see the tears that filled his eyes at the thought of Danny reaching out to him from the other side.
"No, not at all." "Danny seemed agitated this time," Simon told him. "He pushed harder with his energy, gave me a migraine, so it was really important for him to tell you that, and I think he's afraid that you're in danger."
Brent's dry laugh was bitter.
"Nothing new about that."
Danger, like a demon, seemed to haunt Brent. One of these days, his luck wouldn't hold, and he'd finally catch up with Danny.
"If you won't listen for your own sake or for his, then for hell's sake, do it for mine," Simon said wearily. "I get tired of the headaches."
"Roger that," Brent replied. An awkward silence stretched.
"Hey, Simon, thanks. I appreciate it. I do. It just throws me when it happens, you know?"
He also said to tell you that there's no hurry to join him, so don't take chances.
That's Danny, Brent agreed. Always the careful one.
Simon said goodbye, telling him to stop in if he ever made a trip to the beach. Brent stared at the phone after the call ended, ignoring the now cold coffee in his cup, resolutely refusing to top it off with Jack. Starting the morning with a message from his dead twin brother pretty much guaranteed that the rest of the day couldn't get any worse.
Chapter 3. You're sure the pickup was black? Travis watched the man's reaction, looking for any sign he was holding back information.
Yeah, I'm sure.
The long-haul truck driver sported more than a day's worth of salt and pepper stubble, and his hair held the impression of the band of his gimme cap.
Don't think it had a license plate either. You'd think the cops would pick up on that.
Travis suspected that whoever was inside the black truck wasn't worried about mortal police.
Anything else that you noticed? Even the smallest thing might matter.
Chuck Davis, the driver, shifted in on the vinyl diner seat and took a sip of his ice water.
I told the police. I saw the girl standing on the sidewalk, and then she was gone, and then the truck drove away, but I didn't actually see her get into the pickup.
His tone was solemn, as if he were already on the witness stand.
Only other two things probably don't mean anything, but they struck me wrong. The lights dimmed right before the truck left, and there was a strange smell in the air that I ain't never picked up around here before.
The conversation paused as the waitress refilled their coffee, pouring the dark brew into hard-used white stoneware. The Barkeyville truck stop was one of a chain of outposts along Interstate 80, the highway that cut across the top third of Pennsylvania. Good road, but treacherous in the winter with the altitude, and long stretches cut through remote, trackless forest, dotted by tiny, forgettable towns where the exits were few and far between.
Tell me about the lights, Travis pressed, with a sense he was finally getting a break. Wasn't much, just that they all dimmed a bit, then came back, Chuck replied. Didn't go out or nothing, but it was weird because there wasn't a storm.
And the smell?
Sort of like rotten eggs, Chuck answered, and his lip curled as he remembered. Figured something was burning garbage, but it was strange because I hadn't smelled it earlier and it went away after the truck was gone. But for a moment, I thought I'd lose my lunch.
Thank you, Travis said. He put down a 20 to cover their coffee and a generous tip for the server. They had kept the table tied up for almost an hour as he coaxed Chuck through his story, even though the police already had his account on record. Travis withdrew a business card and slid it across the table.
If you think of anything else or see that truck again, please call me.
Chuck met his gaze, his light blue eyes unwavering.
If I see that truck again, I'm gonna run the other way, not stop till I get to the next county. Gave me the creeps.
Travis left the truck stop and drove across the intersection to the all-night convenience store. Angie, the clerk, looked up as he walked in. Her blonde dreadlocks were caught back in a thick ponytail. The style made her face look fragile in comparison, although the pierced eyebrows and the snake bites on her lips suggested defiance, and her flinty gaze challenged anyone who might want to make an issue about her choices.
Travis, what brings you here?
You're the precog, you tell me.
Angie glanced around the store. Its aisles were laid out to make it easy to see anyone lurking or shoplifting, and the cameras and mirrors made sure there were no blind spots. She and Travis were alone.
You want to know about the black truck?
She made it a statement, not a question. And you're the second person today to come asking. Travis swore under his breath.
Let me guess, tall, beefy guy, short blonde hair, ex-military, looked like he'd been in a fight.
That's him.
Her reply confirmed that Brent hadn't given up his dangerous game.
Forget about that guy. Have you seen the truck?
She gave him a look.
Seen or seen?
He shrugged. Either. I'm not the cops. Your word is worth a photo to me.
Good to know.
And she pulled out her vape pen and took a long drag.
Seen, she clarified, tapping a finger to her temple. First time, I didn't know what to make of it. I mean, lots of trucks come through here. Black's a popular color. But the truck I saw in the vision was scary. I don't know why. It just was.
And after that? Travis stayed where he could see out both side doors to the small store, so they wouldn't be surprised by newcomers.
I heard people talking about a little girl who disappeared, Sherry, and a black truck.
And she inhaled the fruit-flavored mist and blew out a smoke ring. So I started paying attention. I didn't get a bad vibe off any of the real trucks that came through here. Then I saw the creepy truck again in a vision, and bam, next day everyone's talking about a woman who went missing down by Knox.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.